Soldiers of Shoot.
Soldiers of Shoot, welcome back to the Impact Review for May 10th, 2019. I am Hollywood Edwards, and I threw out a challenge. I am not alone, for I had the Electric City Saint watch Impact, and he joins me tonight for the Impact Review. Electric City Saint, we have not discussed this show. I'm going to bring you in now and just tease me. Just tell me, are we in for a battle, or are we in for maybe a pleasant surprise?
Well, Mr. Edwards, you're going to find out pretty soon here, bro.
What are you, Killer Cross?
Dude, you're going to be surprised, I think, because I think you and me are going to be on the same page for a lot of stuff, but at the same time, I think I'm going to have a mixed reaction to this first show.
Okay.
So I think there's parts I liked and there's parts I didn't like, and we'll be getting into it here pretty quickly, I guess.
All right, let's just jump on in. So the first thing, now you watched on Twitch too, so everybody knows, correct?
Yeah, I watched it right on my PlayStation. It was pretty easy. I even asked you, like, before we did this, did I have to, like, sign up or anything like that? Nope, I just downloaded the app, and I didn't even type in Impact. I literally just typed in IMP, and it was the first thing that came up, and yep. I found it in 2 seconds. It was the easiest thing I ever did in my life.
Yeah, I don't know what took me so long to try it. I mean, after seeing how easy it is, it just comes right up. There it is. No sign in, no nothing. Beautiful.
Right. Yeah, that's how I felt too. I mean, seriously, like it took like about 2 seconds to find it.
So the show opened up with a highlight package, a recap video, if you will. And I hope that helped you with some things. I'm not going to comment on it, but just give me a brief rundown of what you saw in the recap, because I think this week it was a little bit longer than usual, and I thought that was good because you were watching. So kudos to Impact.
Yeah, maybe we had some inside information there from Surge. He knew we were coming on for this.
I love Surge.
Yeah, me too, dude. And we got a dosage of him later on into the night.
Mm-hmm.
You know, this video package, though, I thought it was done very well. I thought it, like you said, it was a little on the longer side, but it kind of recapped multiple storylines. It wasn't just focusing on like one or two things. I mean, they recapped Elgin's debut and him beating the hell out of Brian Cage, and you know, they had the triple threat number one contender matchup, and you know, there was Rosemary's in there. I mean, dude, there was a lot of stuff, and I generally really liked the feel of the video package. The music and everything they had a, you know, very modern feel to it, yes, as opposed to what WWE does, where everything feels like it's, you know, should have been done 20 years ago. And that, like, I don't know, it's, man, it was like way different than anything they do. I've kind of listened to some of the shows you did lately reviewing it, but you know, I haven't watched in practically almost 8 years or more. So,
wow. Okay.
Yeah, seriously. And, you know, watching that recap, I kind of felt like I kind of had a general idea what was going on. Okay. So that was kudos to them. They did a very good job with that.
All right, cool. All right. So the show opened up with a match. Josh Alexander from the North with Moose taking on LAX in a non-title match. Josh is with Moose because his actual tag partner, and I don't know if Josh Matthews explained that well enough for you, because you're just tuning in for the first time.
They actually did a very good job explaining it. I think that's one thing that it's a touch above it, like what WWE does, where they don't explain anything, and there's no like point or anything to anything they do. This, everything was, you know, well thought out and explained, and it had meaning and purpose to it, which, man, it when it's done so well, it really could make or break your broadcast. And I think it really was a great touch with, you know, them little details of explaining things like that, because seriously, like, I have not watched this in about probably 8 years, and I felt like jumping back in. I felt like I never left, bro.
Awesome. That was one of the first things I noticed about Josh Matthews. I used to give him a hard time way back in the day, and he's doing a phenomenal job on these shows since I've been watching again. And I was hoping that it was enough for me, obviously, because I know what's going on. I just wondered from your perspective if it was. So that's a plus. The match itself, I thought it was okay. There were a couple of high spots I thought that I liked. That Moose drop kick he does, like Okada, I figured you would notice that one.
Yeah, seriously, he, besides Okada and a couple others, Moose has one of the best drop kicks in the business. I mean, seriously, a work of beauty. I saw a lot of improvement from him just in this one match compared to, how he was when I last seen him many years ago. I mean, this guy is this a pure specimen, dude. I
He
mean,
is.
seriously,
He's a
he's a
freak.
freak athlete, and
Yep.
I think he's on the cusp of being a world champion soon. I mean, seriously, he's not really missing that much, in my opinion. He's got a look to him. From what I've seen in the past, he's always had good mic skills. He's definitely good in the ring. He's very reminiscent of, Lex Luger, the total package. I mean, he is that guy, I would say.
Interesting comparison. I would have never put that one together. That's interesting, Saint. Man, you're bringing it tonight already. Look at this. We're 7 minutes in here, and the Saint's bringing
Dude,
it.
the funny thing about this too is it's like, all these years, some things change and then some things over time they stay the same. The first thing, I literally popped right when LAX came out. They have the same
I
song
know, it's
from
awesome.
they have the same exact song from like 8 years ago, dude. And it's hilarious because like it just works for them. Like I think of LAX, I think of that song. It just, it totally fits for them. And Santana and Ortiz, they definitely remind me of the original LAX. I think they very much are in that realm. I think they are doing a good job carrying that banner of, taking on the mantle of that, the name and everything. They're, I think, great successors to that legacy because, LAX all them years, especially when I was watching, bro, one of the premier tag teams, no doubt about it. They killed it each and every single night, bro.
Yep, and I think these two guys here are, like you said, they're carrying it on very well. And I honestly think that they are in a spot right now that they're one of the premier tag teams going. If I don't want them to leave Impact fans, it's not what I'm saying. But you had the Briscoes this week calling out the Usos on Twitter. That's not going to happen. It's not going to happen. But they put a video out like they're going to challenge the Usos. But you have that. You have AEW, everything that they're doing. I think LAX is one of the top tag teams for sure this going right now. But overall, the match itself was pretty good, I thought. And LAX goes over. Non-title, of course. This was, I guess, mainly Moose, Josh Alexander, and All Ego Ethan Page. I guess they have to figure out a new contender. And I think they did tonight. We'll get there. But of course, this is coming off. They're almost, some of these storylines are being reset now. Like you're actually tuning into the beginning of some storylines because they just won the titles back off of Lucha Brothers.
Yeah, I kind of noticed that as the show went on that it did have that feel like they were, coming out of a pay-per-view. There was some things that they're continuing, of course, and then they're, establishing new storylines, which is good to see that they're already doing that. And I could see like what I could see and understand like what they're doing with a lot of this stuff already, which is very good. It's not like, goofy, nonsensical booking that WWE does.
Right, exactly. What did you think of the match overall?
Very good match. I think this was actually one of the first times that I'd seen Josh Alexander before. I'm not very familiar with him. I liked what I seen from him. I like how he has the old school, the wrestling headgear on, like a la Rick Steiner. Thought that was cool. I even like, that they're called the North, him and Ethan Page, because I think the Toronto Raptors, they have that catchphrase or slogan called "We the North." So I guess that's kind of a play on that a little bit. And they even have, similar, colors as far as the ring gear with the red and white. So, I like I said, very good opening match. I seriously have nothing to complain about it.
Okay. All right. So we're off to a good start, Electric City. Moving forward here, we have the Killer Queen herself in the back doing an interview with go ahead, you can applause. Be loud. Be loud. Go She's being interviewed by oh man, brain fart. Melissa
Melissa Santos
Santos,
or
thank you
something,
very
yeah.
much. Jeez. It's late. This is the only downfall with Impact. It's late.
Yeah, because seriously, we basically like started recording as soon as this went off the air. It's like what 12:07 we started.
Yeah. So Madison here is basically saying, the story with her is she just came back, so she's gonna waltz right. She's not gonna waltz right in on Taya and get a shot, and that's basically her story. And she cuts the promo on Taya. They have a match upcoming very soon here in the show, according to my notes. What do you think of seeing the Killer Queen back? Now, have you seen her? Obviously, you saw her on All In, but is this like the first setting you're seeing her on a TV show since back in the day?
Yeah, it is, and dude, it's incredible to realize that she had a kid
I
and it took
know!
time. Dude, she took time off, and she seriously looks no different than she did back in 2000,
It's
2010,
ridiculous.
2011. And what I mean, we'll get into it once the match comes, but I'll just say this: she's light years better in the ring too. And despite taking all that time off, it's honestly like she never left though. Because seriously, I look at her now and she seriously looks no different than she did back in 2011. I mean, hell, she might even be in better shape, as crazy as that sounds.
I think a lot of new mothers would want to know how exactly what she's doing for a workout because
Yeah.
my old guy out there, Jesus. Okay. Anyway, the Killer Queen interview. From there, we go to a match that's setting up, well, a spot, I should say. Interview that is setting up the main event tonight, which is OVE versus Rich Swann, Willie Mack, Fala Ba, Scarlett obviously is there. Melissa Santos interviewing. Tommy Dreamer doing the talking. Now, you haven't seen Tommy in a while, too. Is that correct?
No, I haven't really seen him in quite a while. I've seen, within the last couple of years, I've seen a couple of matches that he's done in House of Hardcore, but other than that,
Okay.
that's outside of the TV realm. This is the first time seeing him on like a TV broadcast in a while, dude.
So, Dreamer's basic message here, I guess, to OVE is we are all going to band together. And he mentioned it's man with woman, it's white with black, with Latina and Asian, and we're all gonna unite together to defeat OVE. What did you think of this Dreamer promo?
Dude, I really like this, and it's because of one reason, which I think you'll probably keen into this because of the fact we've talked about it off air pretty recently. It reminded me very much of Dutch Vanderlyn from Red Dead Redemption, dude. He was doing like the very inspirational ring general speech and like leaning on the troops and everything, and it very, like I said, very inspirational sounding speech. He definitely, this is honestly, it's crazy to say this, but this is one of the better Tommy Dreamer promos I think I've heard practically since like 1998. I mean, dude,
Wow.
I loved it, and seriously, the dude needs to apply for a job at the UN. Because he's like you said, he's bringing together Asians, he's bringing together the black Americans. He's bringing together white guys. I mean, dude, he might be what we need to, down there to bring everybody together.
Yes.
My God, dude.
The uniter, the uniter. You know, there was a spot here too at the end, towards the end, where it sounded like he was getting a little emotional. And it's interesting because if you watch it, you see Willie and Rich look over at him at the same time. And then I think Scarlett looked over at him at the same, like it was like boom, boom, boom. Their head snapped because I think they heard him and they heard that little in his throat. And I think they thought, oh man, he's actually going to break here.
It came across like it was practically a shoot promo because of the emotion that he had into it. I mean, my God, like I said, seriously, light years ahead of what WWE is doing. Because I could pretty much tell, like, the way this was written, there was very little scripting there. They probably give him like maybe three bullet points, hit those, and then just do you, brother.
Yep.
And he nailed it.
That's exactly how it came across too, because I think in the beginning it kind of seemed like he was hitting the points and then he let it go. You know what I mean? And you could feel it. Dude, just awesome stuff. Awesome stuff. It's already, look, we're three segments in here and we're seeing a difference to what we're used to reviewing on
Right,
Wednesday nights.
absolutely. And dude, it seriously, it feels great to get that taste of WWE out of my mouth. You know, seriously, I mean, it's night and day practically.
Yes. Now, this was interesting. Okay, so coming off the pay-per-view, not sure if you know, but Tessa defeated Gail Kim. Gail Kim came out of retirement, and Tessa went over on her, and towards at the end of the match, you know, Tessa thanked her and all that. But Tessa, up till that point, was 100% clear-cut heel. She comes out for commentary, and as soon as she sits down, you can tell she's going babyface. And why is that? Because the match here coming up is Madison versus Taya in a non-title match with Tessa on commentary. So obviously they're going to set up Tessa and Taya. Taya will remain the heel in this program. You can go ahead and comment now. You have some Madison Rain comments in the ring, and also hit on Taya too, because I don't know what your familiarity is with Taya here.
Well, I'll say it again. I mean, I don't really want to go into music too much, but seriously, it was so cool to hear this newer acoustic version of the Killer Queen song. I mean,
Remix.
like I, yeah, I, dude, I guess it's kind of newer because I never heard it before. And yeah, I seriously, dude, I love it. It's almost it almost kind of feels like it's connecting more with like that motherly side that she has now that, you know, that she's had a kid or whatever. Cause it's more like soft. I don't know if you noticed that
Yes,
or
of
not, but
course.
it's like,
Yep.
man, I, it totally, it fit her obviously in the past. I said, it's one of my favorite theme songs from the 2010s era, but now here in this version, it connects even more with her, I think, with the way she is now. I mean, I love it. Now, as far as Taya goes, I don't know, dude. She's one of the people that on the roster that I just don't get the appeal of, and that was one of my worries going into this. You know, I thought it was cool, like the heel mannerism. She didn't like she threw the, you know, her ring jacket at Tessa's face, like on the at the commentary booth. I thought that was kind of cool. And you know, she has fantastic ring work. I'm not gonna deny that, but I don't know. There's just something about her. Like I don't get what the appeal to her is. I mean, I'm sorry. I know there's a lot of fans of hers, but I'm just not one of them.
Oh, it's fair enough. It's fair enough. She has been running around, obviously, with Johnny Impact. They were not together tonight for the first time that since I've been watching again. But I think, I don't know, maybe you would get a different feel for her if you saw her with Johnny.
Right. I also noticed too that she definitely had like that swagger that, you know, Johnny Impact has, and I'd even say like they kind of mentioned she had like a newer outfit, and it did definitely kind of reminded me of something like he would wear, you know, mixed obviously with more like, you know, feminism like with the light blue and the pink and all that. Yeah, she has a good look to her, I think,
I
but
see
I don't
what
know,
you mean. Okay.
like I said, I don't know what it is. I just don't really care for her that much.
From here, RVD, Melissa Santos interview in the back. I'm just gonna go ahead and say it, and they did bring it up. He looked stoned as you know what, bro. RVD was stoned. I don't care. And I'm sure he would admit it. Man, you look at him and oh my God, I don't know how he works like that, but he must be used to it. Basically just, a tease I'm back kind of interview with Santos here. And of course he will come out for a match later on. Thoughts about RVD? I know you are a big fan of RVD. They also mentioned next week's show will be from the 2300 Arena, which we all know is the ECW Arena. I believe they already recorded that. I'm pretty sure that was like last weekend. But I don't look at spoilers because I'm not that guy. If I'm into something, I just let it roll. I don't look at the spoilers. But that arena, did I ever tell you I was in that arena? Like I was in that building?
Yeah, I believe I remember you telling me about it. Maybe even AC might have said something about it. Hell, I think even Stame said something about
We were all in that building, man. Yeah. We were in that building, but we didn't.
Is that when you saw War Machine and all those
Oh,
guys?
yeah. AJ, all of them. A lot of guys. We saw them and in that building, we were there. Okay, anyway. RVD, thoughts?
I again this it remind it was very similar to the Dreamer thing. I think it was this very fun little quick promo from him. It's nothing too overly complicated or forced. I mean, it I know he was it did seem like he was stoned, but I think that's where he does some of his best work, because I mean it came off as a lot more natural than 99% of like the promos WWE does. And just by looking at him, he didn't seem uncomfortable. He didn't seem out of his element. He didn't have to really worry about like remembering any kind of lines or anything. I mean, he seemed very relaxed. I mean, I know it's RVD we're talking about here, but I mean, he's the definition of relaxed, but
Oh
I
yeah.
digress.
Oh yeah. I thought it was funny he's doing the RVD and he's making Melissa do it too. And when she's doing it, she's moving the mic and he's like, "No, just wait. Just, I'll do it. You hold the mic for me," because he's trying to do it into the mic. So he had fun with that too. Very relaxed, very relaxed. We'll agree on that.
It was funny how he was like teasing her, and he was going, "It's not as easy as it looks on TV now, is it?" or something like that. Bro, I thought that was actually legitimately funny.
Yeah, he's pretty good. He seems like a cool dude. From there, another quick one. Rosemary cuts a quick promo on Sue Young and announces that next week from the ECW Arena, which did I ever tell you I was in that building?
I believe you did, but I'm not sure about that. We
Yeah.
have to confirm with AC to make it official.
Okay, yeah, we'll do that. 2300 Arena. Demon collar match next week. Rosemary and Sue Young. I'm assuming that's a dog collar match with her chain. We'll see what kind of gimmick they come up with there. I'm going to assume they're just going to be attached by the collars. I don't know what to expect of that, but it's probably going to be an unbelievable Jimmy Jacobs booked Undead Realm Sue Young Rosemary thing that you won't forget. I'm pretty sure that's what's going to happen. What are your thoughts on this? Now, I know you're not, you're just actually airdropping in on this whole thing, right?
Right. Dude, I'm liking what I'm seeing here from Rosemary. She very much has this definitely, like you said, you and me like this a lot. We like that demonic vibe and stuff. And dude, the way she did the promo was very interesting, because it reminded me of like more, like some horror films, because she tilts her head at different times and like pronunciates different words differently. And there's parts too where she literally like will twitch, which I thought was friggin' badass looking. I mean, especially when you're portraying like a demonic, scary horror film-esque character like that. It was very good. And also, I know you and me aren't really big Mortal Kombat fans, but she kind of reminds me of the character D'Vorah. I'm not sure if you know who that is, but she's like a, I guess she's like a humanoid like insect character where like she has like a she has the hive, which I believe she Rosemary mentioned the hive earlier, or I mean earlier on in the show. So I it definitely reminds me of that, like combined with that horror movie. And dude, the one part that really stuck out to me, she said something about the demon collar being attached. I almost can't even say without laughing. She said it was attached to the jugular, dude. Just like I said, the way she said it was just so incredible because she's like twitching. When
Yeah.
she says it, it's like, my God, it's like next level stuff, bro.
It's awesome. I know. I know. I can't wait to see this. I don't even care what it is. I'm ready.
Dude, it could be the worst match of all time. I think I'd still enjoy it. I
Yes,
think that this
exactly.
might be the most I'm looking forward to out of like what they advertise for the next week's show. I think that's probably what I want to see the most.
Wow, okay. All right, that says a lot. Jordynne Grace defeats Alexia, I believe. Alexia Nicole. I've never seen this girl before. I don't know if she's just enhancement talent or if she actually is a part of the roster. Jordynne Grace defeated her in a pretty quick match. Thoughts on this one? Because I'm sure you've heard Stames and I talk about Jordynne Grace and just the power that she delivers her moves in. She never wastes like a minute of movement, whether she's hitting the ropes or laying in a move. And I think she did it here again. Dude, this girl is very impressive to me.
Yeah, I'll say that she reminds me of a more athletic, more gifted version of China. She has that very much has that strength ability to her. And yeah, I think she has an underrated level of athleticism. I don't know. Again, I hate to say this. She's another one of them that I don't get the appeal of. I know Joe White's a big fan of her as well. And I don't know. I just there's something about her, and more so her than Taya Valkyrie, because there was some stuff I did like out of seeing out of her in that match earlier. But I don't know, Jordynne Grace. There's just I don't know what it is. I just don't really care for her that much, or don't see the appeal to her. But
Wow.
I mean, like you said though, she's very talented as far as the in-ring aspect goes.
Yeah, she's really grown on me over the past couple weeks. So that was just a quick, basically a squash. From there, in the back, the North, Josh Alexander is talking to Ethan Page. He wants to come out for Page's match against RVD. And there's a reason why I like this spot, Saint. And the reason
I did
is,
too, and I think you and me might have the same reason. Go ahead.
okay. He specifically said we're a team. Whatever we do together. And Paige agreed. It's that simple, WWE. It's that simple. And guess what? He went out with him for the match. Wow. What are your thoughts on this?
No, seriously, that's exactly the same reason I was gonna say. Because he basically says they're a tag team through and through, and that he don't give a shit. He's gonna come out there with them anyway, even though it's not his match. And I really like that because it's like again, you know, just the way that they're presented that they are a pure tag team. They're not, just a makeshift two guys stuck together that have no chemistry or nothing in common with them. These two, they fit together. I think they make sense together. They're both Canadian professional wrestlers that have been in the business, a decent amount of time that have worked with one another on and off. And, tag team wise, I think they make sense. And like it's not like WWE where you have Aleister Black and Ricochet that make no sense.
Exactly.
These guys are the total opposite.
Exactly. Kira Hogan is interviewed backstage. A lot of work from Melissa Santos tonight. A lot of interviews. But I love that Melissa Santos is on here a lot because to me, they're setting things up and progressing things just with quick interviews in the back or quick promos in the back. And I love it. Kira Hogan, she's talking about Rosemary. Rosemary is, you know, basically wanting to handle Soo Young alone. So she's telling Kira, you know, basically that's where Kira's coming from here. She's basically getting the message that Rosemary's been giving her. So she's going to leave her alone. But now it seems, because of the way Rosemary's been acting toward her, she says to Jordynne Grace, who happened to walk into the shot, I'm not exactly sure why, you know, Jordynne wants to be her friend again. And I don't know, there's something with the friendship there. I guess Jordynne abandoned her when she chased Taya, you know, just recently. Kira says Rosemary can go die just like Allie did, and she stormed off. Now she means that legitimately because Allie died.
Right.
So
Yeah.
that's mighty strong words here, Electric City Saint. What are your thoughts?
Yeah, it's funny. I absolutely love that line, you know, that she could die just like Allie, because I think it's cool that they're actually still acknowledging that character, even though she's left for AEW and all that. So I think it was cool that, you know, it's she's still being acknowledged as, you know, part of the past of that history with the Unknown Realm storyline. So very, very cool that they went there with that.
Yes.
And you know, I haven't seen a whole lot of Kira Hogan, but I think she looks like she might be a very good heel on their hands coming. I mean, going forward, because she definitely has that like cockiness, I think, to her. And she even says like she has been trying to be friends with people since she joined the company, and look where that got her. It didn't get her nowhere, and she doesn't need any friends. And I guess going forward, she's probably going to be, you know, that cocky, you know, heel that, like, that's going to be more, you know, singles based, I guess. I mean, maybe she'll still do some stuff with those too, but I mean, I think they have potential there for her to be, you know, maybe a couple months be a top challenger for that women's title.
Yeah, and it makes a lot of sense because Jordynne Grace obviously doesn't have a dance partner now. Tessa just, I don't want to say she switched to being a heel. I don't, it wasn't a turn per se, if you want to call her a tweener, but she's definitely playing a face now. So, what better way to get Jordynne Grace a dance partner? Kira Hogan. So, we'll have to keep an eye on that. Next match. Here comes your boy, RVD, high as fuck. Versus Ethan Page. Great part of the match. Josh and Don Callis made mention of the fact that smoking weed is legal in a recreational way in Canada, and there's RVD. Look at him. So they basically addressed it, which I loved. I thought that was awesome. The match itself, dude, I don't know how these guys are doing this. You know, General Stames and I did the Impact show WrestleMania week, the pay-per-view. He and Sabu, we're watching this and we did the show and we're going, oh my God, how do these guys still do this? You could say what you want about Rob. Yes, he was high. He's always high. He's permanent high, okay? Yes, he's a little thick around the middle, okay? He still does the same shit, Saint. He hasn't lost a step. Like, I'm reading that chat going up. He's lost 40 steps, you know? No, bro. He still does the Rolling Thunder. He still does the frog splash. He still owns the ropes. When he gets up on the ropes, he leaps up onto the ropes just like he always did. This guy, man, I mean, for 48 years old and taking some time off like he has, my God, forget about it. Very good job by RVD, in my opinion. He goes over Ethan Page in what I would say was a pretty good match. Up until this point, I think this match itself kind of picked the pace up a little bit for the show.
Yeah, I would agree with that, because I kind of felt like that Jordynne Grace match, I kind of felt like that, like obviously it was a squash, but I kind of felt like that kind of sucked the air out of the arena a little bit. Even though I liked the Madison Rayne, you know, Taya Valkyrie match, I also thought too, they, for whatever reason, they just weren't getting behind Madison that much, which is kind of a shame, because like I said, you and me love her pretty much. Probably one of my favorite knockouts that they've had there, you know, since the entirety of that company. And dude, like RVD, it's crazy that you said people said he lost 40 steps. Dude, he looks it's insane, dude. He looks like he hasn't aged at all since
It's
1997.
crazy.
I mean, I'm like amazed by it. Like even like Dreamer, he doesn't really look that much older either. And I don't know, some guys like that, they had an ECW have aged really badly, and these two, man, like I said, they look like it's 1997 all over again.
It's crazy.
I mean, it's crazy.
Really is.
And yeah, I mean, dude, I mean, this actually might have been my favorite match of the night too, because there was some really good stuff here. I mean, they utilized, them actually, the North being a tag team and doing heel tag team antics. They
That's
had,
weird.
yeah, I know, a big shocker there that, it's something that WWE just can't think to do. I mean, I thought it was brilliant. They basically it, the in, basically drop like switched out into the outside there, and the North, they tried to take advantage of having that two-man advantage to distract RVD, and he just wasn't falling for it. But then finally they get it to work, and it was amazing, because it's like he Alexander steps in front of the corkscrew leg drop that he does, that RVD does, like on the barricade, and then that finally allowed Page to capitalize and take it to Van Dam there. And dude, I love that they did that. They don't do that much. I mean, of course, managers might do it more often, but it's cool to see that utilized in, like in the tag team like realm of things, that he was, getting involved and trying to help his buddy there. I mean, he later into the match too, he even like he prevented RVD from hitting the frog splash the first time. He jumped up on the apron there and was holding his leg, and dude, I love stuff like that. Need to see more of it.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Do you have anything else on this match before I move forward?
The only thing I would say is, again, it's so funny that, some things change and some things change is or they stay the same. I mean, RVD literally has the same song from 10 years ago from Kushinator. And dude, it's so funny that I literally like remembered the lyrics to that. I was practically ready to sing along to it. I mean, Jesus Christ, man.
Awesome. Awesome. So RVD is back for now. We'll see where they go with him. Now, from here, this is interesting, and I wanted to make mention of this. It's a Brian Cage injury update, the new Impact World Champion. When we are talking on this channel, we tend to make fun of marks a lot. Not that we're not marks, but you know who I mean. Okay. I don't like hearing the you deserve it, because in the back of my head, when I hear the you deserve it chant, I think it's a fake belt in a fake fight. Do they really deserve it? In this case, I'm seeing Brian Cage in Lucha Underground season one years ago. And obviously, you see him for the first time. You're like, oh my God, what the hell is this guy? He's a freak, right? Freak athlete, freak specimen. This guy deserves a run at the title, so I'm going to be a hypocrite and now I'm going to mark out. I feel bad for this guy because we were all hoping that he would knock Johnny Impact off. He does. Okay, so the booking is there. And he took that spot off the ramp there at the pay-per-view. And I heard an interview with him that week, and he said he did what he said on the show tonight. He said in the interview, it was a busted open interview I heard, he lost feeling like as soon as he landed. And he said, if when you go back and look at it, it doesn't even look like a bad bump. It just, he hit something in his back, and he said the right part of his body went numb. And you could see during the match, it being the main event, there was definitely an audible called, because you can see him and Johnny talking throughout the match for the rest of it. And then, of course, Elgin came down and did the spot. I don't even know why Cage still did that, but he did. So kudos to him. But after they showed this on Twitch, Melissa Santos is obviously hosting Twitch in between commercials. And they're dating at least. I don't know if they're married or whatever, but they're together. But she actually said, we will give you an update, you know, as soon as we know something. So, Cage, as far as that goes, it sucks that that happened. However, she said that, or maybe he said it, he has to wait until the swelling goes down and then they need to take a look at if there's anything broken underneath, I think he said. Now, I might be mixing up the Busted interview with what he just said, but this could be, he may have to vacate this because in reality, he may be injured. He may have a broken bone underneath the swelling on his back. It's a weird injury, you know? And she even said, which I really liked, I don't know if you caught this on the break, but Melissa Santos said, you know, it's that bump card we always talk about. So it didn't look like a bad injury, but you're always punching, you know, holes in your bump card. And I appreciated that as a fan because they're not trying to pretend that it didn't happen, like it's not real. They're obviously together. She's giving us an update about Brian Cage, and she's talking to us about the injury. So just that sliver alone, Saint, I wanted to point this out to you and make it a big deal because it's a wrestling show. What Impact is doing here, they're letting you in on the actual story of what's going on with Brian Cage, and they're putting it on TV and they're putting it on Twitch, obviously, in their broadcast. So what are your overall thoughts on this injury? Because this is like, man, apparently the dude is a really good guy. Apparently he was supposed to have a big run here, and apparently it might be taken away because of a weird injury. What do you make of it?
Yeah, it's from what I've read about it, it's definitely a very obscure injury, and it's like you said, the timing couldn't be any worse. I mean, we got to just hope that it's not as serious as they think it's going to be, and you know, hopefully that he would be able to still defend the title because, and you said it, I think he's had a lot of years in the business, and I think he's finally gotten to the point where he's really over, and I think he's busted his ass that. It really would be a shame, like that this whole thing might be taken away from him just like that. I mean, freak things happen in the wrestling business. Obviously, it's like there's so much risk of an injury, even on the most simplistic move. So, I mean, he knew obviously all them guys they know what they're getting into, but at the same time, it's very frustrating and sad, like when it actually does happen, especially to somebody so gifted like him. I mean. It's rough, dude. It really is.
Brian Cage, get well soon. I was being very dramatic there. Did you catch that, Saint?
Yeah, I did.
Now, I never met Cage. Have you?
Nope.
See, he wasn't in the building. Did I tell you I was in 2300, the ECW arena? All right, moving from there, we have the investigative reporter, Menendez, there. He calls himself an investigative reporter every week, Saint. And usually, because he was following Johnny Impact around every week to week, the gimmick here is he's calling himself an investigative reporter, and Johnny Impact will always crush him for being a mark. Like a Meltzer, basically. He's basically playing like a dirt sheet writer, and Johnny Impact calls him out on it all the time. So that's the setup here, just so you know. Elgin's in the back. Johnny Impact walks in. He's doing his Impact self. I'm going to assume that this is the fix for Cage until they figure it out. I'm going to assume that Elgin and Johnny will be going up against each other here moving forward. What were your thoughts on this whole thing, especially with Elgin just coming into the company? What were your thoughts?
Well, I'll start off with Elgin, and then I'll get into the actual promo. I think Elgin signing with TNA is a very, very wise move. I think he's a good fit there. I think he's very much based out of Canada, so I think he, you know, obviously he's going to be getting better reactions and has less travel time and stuff. Obviously, if he's going to be, you know, fighting there all the time, and I think, like, seriously, I think he is such a good fit for that company also just because of the fact that, you know, I think he has that style and appeal to him. I think, New Japan, he obviously wasn't going to really go anywhere or get anywhere with that. I mean, he had a couple title runs, and but he was never obviously a main eventer. And then TNA, he can be a main eventer. I think, seriously, that's the perfect landing spot for him. And I think, honestly, I kind of wish he went there sooner, because I think he's a perfect fit for them. And the promo itself, I thought it was very, very good. I think, I thought it was funny how Impact enters in and he's telling the guy to hit the bricks, the investigative reporter. Shout out Dave Bowman.
Bowman.
Seriously, I thought like that was very funny. Like I kind of picked up, like, I didn't get the whole, like, this whole backstory, but I kind of picked up like what was going on with them two. And they were going back and forth, him and Elgin, and I think the stuff that they were saying, it's not the most, deepest stuff, but at the same time, it's simple storytelling for wrestling that, eventually it's gonna lead to them having a match. And I think that's a smart move going forward. If this is, if Cage is gonna be out for a while, I think that's probably their next best bet as far as their big match.
Makes sense. Makes sense. Yeah, I'll echo your sentiments too with Elgin being, it's actually a perfect, he's perfect for Impact, I think.
Absolutely.
He doesn't get lost in the sauce like he did in New Japan, because my God, their roster's insane. But over here, now you have a main event picture looking with better with Cage, Impact, and now you're going to add Elgin. It's perfect. He has a chance now to get over to a level, I think, that he can. I don't want to say that he hasn't been over with the fans before, but you know what I'm saying? Like, he can get his hands on that title and go on a little run. That might be something pretty good if he can become a face for Impact, So I think it's a good pickup by them. I do. I don't mind Elgin, but I never loved Elgin. So I'm very interested in seeing what they do with him, and if I could, become a huge fan of Elgin, it'll be interesting to see. From
Yeah,
there,
you and me have the same exact thoughts on that. I never was a huge fan of him, but at the same time, like, I can enjoy some of the stuff he's done, and he's had a very good career turnaround, I think, because a few years back there was issues with him with spousal abuse or whatever the hell that was all about, and seeing where he went from that and being able to recover from all that nonsense and make something big of himself that he's done, it's very good to see.
four-way tag team match we have, and I need some opinions from you here, Saint, because this is a problem for me on their roster. Okay, so we have the Deaners, we have the Desi Hit Squad, we have Brett Banks and Aiden Prince, who these two guys were obviously thrown together. They've been doing X Division matches on the shows, and the Rascals, Wentz and Desmond Xavier here. Desi Hit Squad goes over. I thought the match was okay. They were trying to do the high-paced four team, whatever you want to call it, like you see everywhere else in wrestling now. Wherever you want to go with this, the match itself, the guys in the match, to me, none of these teams really screams. I don't know. I kind of like Wentz and Xavier when they're doing solos. That would be the Rascals. Aiden Prince, I like him as a solo guy, but the rest of it's just, I don't know, man. It's very mediocre to me, the whole thing.
Yeah, I hate to say it, but I kind of felt that way too. I felt like, they all look like tag teams, which is a huge plus. They definitely had that, like, they could tell that they're actually together and have similar outfits and all that stuff, which is a nice touch. But at the same time, they all kind of felt like they were like, I hate to say it, but they all kind of felt like they're like mid-card tag teams. Like, they're not really at that upper echelon of teams that are going to be getting title shots every week. And, I It's funny because I mean the Desi Hit Squad, I think there could be something there, but at the same time, I don't know if they're really, championship material, especially when you have all these incredible teams there in TNA. I mean, I would even say, dude, they might have one of the better, if not best, tag teams divisions in the whole wrestling business right now. A lot of great stuff there. And the funniest thing I took away from this was seeing Cody Deaner, because I don't know if you even remember this dude. Back in 2009, he was actually in TNA. He was in like that storyline where he was the love interest of ODB. And she handpicked him from the audience one night when she said, like, one lucky guy is going to get to spend the night with her. And they actually turned it into an angle and ran with it. And they even had a series of matches between them two and Abyss and Daphne, and a lot of interesting stuff. I mean, it's funny seeing how he really hasn't changed a whole lot between now and then, but I think this is a huge upgrade from him doing stuff like that, or even losing to Desmond Wolfe in 5 seconds.
That's a shot from the past.
Yeah, see, like I said, I was a big
You
TNA
were,
guy in the
yep.
past. But now it's like the last several years, I kind of fell out with it and just wasn't really following it. But for the most part, I kind of do know my history with TNA. I mean, I was a fan back when it was in the Impact Zone and even when it was the TNA Asylum. So,
Nice.
it's at the same time, I realized, times are going to change the company, and the way that the thing is, like the way everything was presented was a lot different at the same time. I mean, it's definitely no Impact Zone, but at the same time, the way everything was presented tonight, I liked it. It did feel small, but at the same time, it still felt like it was big budget. They didn't really feel like they were like a small indie promotion, like with everything, how it was produced and shot and everything.
Right. In the back, Killer Cross is doing a backstage promo slash voiceover to highlights with him and Eddie Edwards. The feud is ongoing, hyping up a match at ECW Arena. Obviously, Eddie Edwards now is he's doing the hardcore thing. His little kendo stick there, he named him Kenny, so he's like this crazy hardcore guy now. I don't know if you were aware of that transition, Saint, but Killer Cross, I don't know if you've seen him, but he is money. He's a future star, dude. Very good on the mic and very good in the ring. He's basically a killer, like in the ring. So, thoughts on this one? Would you have any interest in seeing this?
Yeah, I want to see more of Killer Cross for sure. I mean, I like the way that the promo, the video package came across. He has this very dark and methodical, and I would even say calculating, like it lives up to his name, like a serial killer with like a high IQ. It very much reminded me of that. He definitely had like this intensity and anger and level to him, but also like this weird calmness. And even earlier in the night, they had a bumper for Impact Plus, and I really, but when he was on, I really took a lot away from that. I mean, I think part of it was in character, but it was also part of like out of character. I mean, he had some cool lines. Everybody pays the toll. I really thought that was pretty awesome. And the one part of it that really made me laugh, he goes, "If you don't subscribe, he's gonna punch a cinder block into your face." And, dude, that is pro wrestling at its finest right there. That is something straight out of the 80s. I mean,
Yes.
that's you gotta love that. I mean, my God, it's just so much better than the stuff I've been like stuck with the last couple months. I mean, oh my God, it's just, I mean, dude, I don't even know if this guy's supposed to be a heel or a face, but he definitely comes across as like this gray area badass, either way you slice it. And I really like that aspect of him. And like I said, like a couple minutes ago, I really want to see more of this guy.
Awesome. Awesome. The Rascals in their clubhouse. Now, this whole thing is a take on
Dude, I
the
love
70s
this.
show, right?
Yeah, I was gonna mention
Okay.
that, yeah.
So they had LAX there today, and they're handing shots of, I guess, tequila, I would assume, to the Rascals, and they can't handle it, obviously. So They do this. They've been doing this, and the laugh track that they put in, it's a complete, thing like that 70s show. It's funny. I guess maybe the Rascals will be taking on LAX because LAX happened to be there. They didn't say that, but what did you think of this spot here? Again, you're pointing out differences that you've seen so far with TNA or Impact and WWE and TNA, actually, old TNA. Now we have alcohol and drugs, Saint. Go ahead and take it because I wouldn't say it's PG,
I mean that's the weirdest thing, like with PG, it's like there's so many things that you could still push the boundaries with, but I think WWE they just keep it to the point where it's like practically like the 7 and 10 age group where it's like they just will not really risk doing any kind of stuff like that, which I get it. At the same time, they're a big, corporately owned business and all that stuff. And I mean, but at the same time, it's like, dude, seriously, I don't know why they just don't take no risk sometime. I mean,
Right.
little things like that could be enough to bring, jackasses like you and me back into the fold, Like, I mean, I don't get it sometimes. I really don't. I mean, this was like, it really didn't lead to a whole lot or anything, but it was a fun little, segment. Like you said, it seemed like it was very based on, that 70s show. They're going around in the circle of like the smoke and haze and all that. And I liked it. I mean, I'm obviously a big straight edge guy, but at the same time, I could kind of get the appeal and the fun of like, stuff like this, the humor of it. And
Right.
my only complaint was, where the hell was RVD? Because he would have been perfect for this freaking
Listen,
thing.
listen. Impact, if you're listening, you need to do a segment with RVD. You need to before he goes.
Yes,
I don't care what
please,
it is. It doesn't
seriously.
have to have meaning. Just put him in there. It must be done. The crowd will pop when they see that. So, yeah, pretty much, just a fun segment. And then on to the main event where Rich Swann, Willie Mack, Falabaugh, and Tommy Dreamer take on OVE. OVE rules, which means there are no rules. Basically, a street fight. Coupled pretty decent spots in this match. OVE goes over. Is this the first time you're seeing Callahan since NXT, I guess?
No, I've seen him a couple times since then.
Okay.
He has some of the craziest, most hardcore stuff that, it practically puts 1998 ECW to shame, practically. Some of the
Yeah.
stuff that he's done lately, I mean, it's next level stuff.
The Dave Christ, or no, maybe it was Jake, one of the Christs, the unprotected headshot, bro. He fell over and was selling, and there was nothing but blood on the top of his head. He didn't protect it. Chris, you don't have to do that for me. Just throw your hand up. I mean, it's cool that you did it, but you don't have to. You don't have to do that for us. The cutter off the ladder was pretty decent move, and the Samoan drop. It happened so fast when Fulton, I love the Fulton. I love the 6'9" monster or whatever the hell he is. I love that dude. He comes off that ladder. It happened so quick. I didn't even realize it until Josh said, "Samoan drop," and then they showed the replay. Dude, that landed perfectly. I don't know how the hell those guys did that. This guy is a monster coming off a ladder onto a short guy like Falabaugh. Perfectly nails it into a Samoan drop. There were a couple moves like that in this that I was really impressed with. The Tommy Dreamer bowling ball gimmick outside off the top. Couple good spots in this match. What did you think?
Yeah, that spot was really funny. I think even Matthews goes, it reminded him of a bowler falling down a mountain. And dude, I could
Yes.
picture that with Dreamer, dude. Oh man, there was really some amazing spots during this. I mean, even that the Fulton, the power bomb onto the follow bomb, the two chairs. I mean, my God, that the strength that requires. It's is insane. And then even right after that, they did the really cool double stomp onto the barbed wire chair on to fall upon. He still kicks out at two. I mean, way to make him look freaking awesome as hell and like a total badass with some heart, kicking out of some crazy shit like that. Because that was back to back. They did the power bomb and then right went into the other spot like that. The one spot I thought that was really cool, I don't even know if you noticed this. I'm sure you probably did. Swan was really hesitant. He was like thinking about it, and he goes up to the ladder, and they slowly pan the camera up the ladder, and right behind him
Loved it.
is Fulton.
Coming
And
up the
dude,
other side.
that was incredible.
Yep.
Yes, the way that they shot that was beautiful. I seriously thought that was the friggin' coolest thing practically that they did the whole night, the way that they shot that.
Yeah, that was cool.
And I really like, I could kind of don't really care for the whole Lego stuff, but at the same time, like, I could realize like how painful that is. And dude, that, the pulling pile driver, I think they call it the Cactus Special or something like that, onto the Legos, man, that what a way to end the match. That was brutal looking.
Yeah, the Legos for me, you have to have your feet off for it to work for me, or your shoes off, I
Right.
mean. And
Yeah, and the good thing too was in they actually did they like made a point of
they
that
made a
with
big,
Bob
big deal out of it.
Bob. Yeah.
Yep, that was awesome. So let's just stop it there. Overall thoughts, Saint, this is the first time you're seeing Impact since it's been Impact, TNA, quote unquote, in a long ass time. So give me your overall thoughts. And I guess the big question is, will you be back next week for more Impact?
Coming off of some shitty ass shows that we've seen lately, this was a breath of fresh air. It was, I'm like almost at a loss of words for it because I really genuinely enjoyed this. Now I'll say this, I'm not totally like super enthralled just yet. I think it's going to take a couple weeks for me to get into it, decide if I really like enjoy and like this quite a lot, but to see like if I'm going to really like start to invest into it. But at the same time, like this was a very good show to reintroduce me to the brand and potentially regain me as a viewer. I definitely will be giving it another shot next week after seeing this. I think the first maybe half hour of the show was very good. The middle was a little bit weak with those two women's matches, even though like I said, I like Madison Rayne quite a bit. I kind of The show kind of lost a lot of momentum, I thought, at that point. But then, not long after that, the hot streak just went up and up and up. And they had me glued to my TV set for the whole rest of the show there. And I think they did a good job of getting that fire back from the fans, after that, the middle of the show. That was a little bit on the weak side. So I would say definitely a lot better than anything I've seen probably about a month or more outside of, the WWE realm. I mean, there's been some good stuff with New Japan and Ring of Honor, but seriously, this is like light years ahead of what WWE's doing. It don't matter how much money they have or how many, big production and everything they have, multi-million dollar setup. None of that matters when you have such delivery and like presence and everything else that this show delivered in 2 hours.
Wow.
I mean, man, seriously,
Wow.
within the first half hour, they got more done in that first half hour than Raw did in 3 hours.
It's true. It's true, man. You had me worried in the beginning when you were like, yeah, and you had a couple complaints, but
Right.
I gotta say, Saint, the first time I watched it, Stames and I did the initial experiment. We're gonna watch Impact. We watched it. He called me. He said, "Are you ready?" And I said, "I don't know, man. I guess it was okay, but yeah, we'll do the show." And then the next week came around and he said, "Are we going to do this again?" And I thought, "Yeah, I'll give it a go. Maybe it'll get better." And now, of course, you've been listening to the shows I've been doing. I'm all in. Like, I was all in after 3 weeks. So I would say right now you're probably more positive about it than I was the first week. So Man, I'm excited to see what you think of next week, because if you have these storylines progress, now you're going to be able to see what they do to follow up to what you just saw this week. I'm really interested to see what you say next week.
Yeah, because like I even noticed this not long into it. It definitely felt like it was a building block show coming out of a pay-per-view, which is okay because now I think this is probably a good time for me to get back into Impact because it's like they're just starting over now with newer storylines that they're going to be developing over the coming weeks. And of course, they're still following up with some of the stuff like you said, Tessa and Taya, which would be a very good match, I think, going forward. I'd like to see what they do with that. And of course, I'm sure Madison Rayne, if she's like 3-0 against Taya, I'm sure she gets a title match soon. I don't think she'll win, but I'm looking forward to the actual title match and seeing how like Taya weasels her way out of it because that could be a very good match, I think. And I gotta admit, you did a good job selling me on getting back in the TNA. I partially attribute it to that, and I also partially attribute it to the fact that, like I said, I'm so burnt out on WWE. But the one thing, and I didn't even tell you this, the one thing I think that really put me over wanting to get back into TNA and give it a chance, about a week and a half ago, I rewatched the classic match between AMW and Triple X. Loser has to disband. Dude, I seen that when it was live because I ordered the pay-per-view, and that match stands the test of time. It may just be one of the greatest tag team wrestling matches of all time. And that, I think, was one of the reasons that got me, motivated to give Impact another try.
Well, I'll say this too. We got a new subscriber this week, and I forget his last name. So, subscriber, if you're listening, I think it was Jeff. Great name, by the way. I would say the perfect name. I'm Jeff too. He said on one of the comments, it was a WWE video we did. I think it was the ratings one we did. He said, basically, WWE's trash. Watch Impact. He went back and heard one of our Impact reviews, one of the shows that I did, or with Stames, I can't remember. And he said he just got Impact Plus. And you just brought that up to me. I think I'm gonna have to check out Impact Plus. They're giving away a 30-day free trial. Now I know that this was Global Force. Global Force Wrestling, and then that went away, but the name was Global Force, I want to say Network, but I don't know if it was Network. GFN? I think it might have been. But they repackaged it. So the Impact Plus now. I'm definitely wanting to see if the Asylum is on there, all the Asylum years. And I want to see if that section that we're talking about, Saint, from 2009, 2010 to what, 13, 14? You know that whole section that we
Right.
always wax poetic about friggin' AJ and the aces and eights and all that good stuff. Man, if those two things are on there, I don't know, maybe we should just start doing classic TNA videos and just talking about old Impact episodes. And I mean, at this point on the channel here, my God, this Monday and Tuesday thing is just, it's like a vampire, dude. I mean, it really is. Like, you go back and listen to that. Like, I looked at the channel today, and I don't know, it's like I don't know, 18, 22 views or something. And Stames heard it, and I'm going, dude, I just feel like it's a vampire that just sucked our souls out of that show. Like, you can hear it, dude, on that show. I mean,
Yeah,
Impact, man. Maybe Impact can save us here, especially until we figure out what the hell AEW is. I mean, even if AEW, well, we know, I think next Wednesday they're having the big announcement, but that's only going to give us 2 hours a week. I mean, why not delve into the past of Impact and TNA? Saying, I don't know, might be a good option. What do you think?
Yeah, I think going forward it might be something I'm going to consider more often. I definitely don't think this is a one-time deal, which I think you had fears that it might be.
Big fears, especially in the beginning when you're like, I don't know, man. I think we're gonna have some problems here. I thought, oh shit.
Yeah, see, that's the thing. You don't know what you're gonna get with the Saints sometimes.
The Saints swerve. Okay, so
Like I said,
go
though,
ahead.
I don't want to like sell people on this, but at the same time, like if you have never seen that match before and you're a big fan of tag team wrestling, I'm telling you, I really encourage you to go back on and see that Triple X versus AMW match because it's right on YouTube. That's where I watched it. It's the whole entire match. It's on their Impact Classic series. And like I said, it may just be one of the greatest tag team matches of all time. The pure emotion and adrenaline and energy and between the actual athletes, the fans, and the commentary team is just completely, it's quintessential. It made like seriously, it's utterly amazing. I can't say enough about it. If you like seriously, if you have no faith in tag team wrestling right now, go back and like see that, and you could see just the upper echelon of what tag team wrestling can be, and rightfully should be. Maybe within the next couple of years, I think TNA is still waving that banner quite strong for tag team wrestling. I think once AEW kicks off, I think that's going to give them a platform to, bring that back to the forefront and be a very big part of professional wrestling business.
I'm interested to see where we go from here, Saint. Any final thoughts on May 10th, 2019, Impact TV show? Go.
Well, I guess I'll just do it this way. I'll give it a rating. I'll give it like a B plus. Very like for
Okay.
that's still very strong in my opinion,
Very
especially
strong.
realizing this is the very first time I've watched this show in about 8 years. That's I give it high regards. Like I said, there was only a little couple parts that I kind of had complaints about, but other than that, I think it was. I'm going to say it this way. If you have not watched Impact Wrestling at all, like if you're somebody like me that hasn't watched it in so long, I think this is the perfect like launching point to get you back into Impact because they did a very good job showing off a good chunk of their roster and even the people that weren't actually in action. Some of them were utilized, in backstage promos or in, the video packages like the Rosemary or the Killer Cross, videos that they did. I mean, you got a little taste of everything there. There was like, I mean, really, it was great how there was the very good in-ring action. There was funny promos, and there was also, very intriguing parts where you kind of like, if you haven't watched it before, like I have, you're interested in seeing what the hell is going to be going on next week.
In closing, I will just add, Jeff, thanks for the sub. If you haven't subbed already, please do so. And let us know down in the comments if you what do you want to see? What do you want to see from the SOS channel here? There's a lot of channels that cover a lot of wrestling. If there's something as a subscriber that you're not getting that you would like to see, put it down in the comments. Whether that's old shows or old matches, or you want us to do, I don't know, top fives of our favorite, whatever, this, that, the other thing. Let us know down in the comments, please. Impact fans, remember, don't let the douches on social media that worship WWE, don't let them get to you. Because I didn't think of Impact for a long, long time. And now I feel like every wrestling fan should check out Impact on Friday nights because that crap that they're doing on Monday and Tuesday, it doesn't compare. It doesn't come close to the 2 hours that Impact is giving us on Friday night. So, for the Electric City Saint, I am Hollywood Edwards. This is the Soldiers of Shoot. Like, comment, share it, subscribe, leave us a comment. Subscribe, leave us a comment, subscribe, and leave us a comment, subscribe. Thanks for listening, and we'll see you next time.